it is no secret that women get the short end of the stick, so to speak, when it comes to how they are treated and viewed in various religions and societies. If one was to examine the workforce, one would realize that women do all the work while men get all the credit. Putting it generously, women are generally treated and viewed as less than men in many societies and communities. Today, inshallah, our aim is to focus on whether is it the religion's fault or is it the followers' fault. Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the second episode of the Muhammadian Blossom with me, your host, Ahmed Ali. Now, Sayed Mudhafar Al-Qazwini is joining us tonight to discuss the differences and correlations in all religions and how they treat and view women and generally while linking it to Fatima Zahra alayhi salam. Assalamu alaikum, Sayyidina.
Alaykum as-salam.
How are you?
Alhamdulillah.
Allah khaliikum, inshaAllah. Now, in the previous episode, we did touch upon how Fatima Zahra alayhi salam, her dad's involvement, Prophet Muhammad, in her life, and how that's also important for us as fathers to be as involved as possible within the lives of our daughters, equally to our sons. Tonight, I want to touch upon something very important, and along the way, we'll get to clarify some of the misconceptions, clear them up.
Inshallah.
But first, before getting into the specifics, I want to know, how did religions pre-Islam view and treat women? And did Islam adopt the same method, or did it seek to reform?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Women in most settled societies around the globe throughout the ages and the centuries, and virtually through all the classes of society, whether they were the lower class or even whether the higher ranks or the higher classes of societies throughout time, whether it was the Persian Empire, the Mesopotamian Empire, whether it was within the Romans or the Greeks, women have always experienced low status. So this is not something that is directed towards Islam today. And of course, it's a false accusation. But we as Muslims, we have to clarify to the world that how are women generally treated within their societies, and other world religions, how did they perceive woman, and how did they give her value, or how did they understand her existence to be? So her existence was always experienced by low status. There was always exploitation, oppression, and her existence was always secondary to men. The inequality of the sexes between men and women, that the man is the master when it came to economical, cultural, political, intellectual life. Always women had to play a subordinate and a submissive role. Only in recent years, women have stepped out of the kitchen and started thinking that we need to have a feminist movement, asking the world for equality or proving to the world that we are equal. Because societies never saw them equal and never gave them the equality. They were always living a subordinate and submissive life. So only in recent years things have changed, and they did not change because society started giving it to them. Societies changed because they started demanding it. You see the difference?
Yeah.
So in prior societies like the Romans, the Greeks, they didn't see any value for women. Not just that she didn't have value, but for instance, they used to think that she didn't even have a soul. She was just, you know, created by Satan or Lucifer, as the old scriptures say, and she was there to destroy man. and she was nothing but evil. So you could have done anything with her. She's just an object. She's no different than your goat. You could sell her, buy her, even if she's your daughter. You could give her away. You could sell your wife. They didn't. These positions or marital statuses meant nothing. And especially when they saw that they believed that she had no soul and she was created by the devil. The devil, so she was a destroyer of societies. Whenever wars broke out, they would always say, you know, a woman was behind it.
Mm-hmm. Who believed in these ideas?
The Romans, the Greeks.
Oh, so ancient times.
Ancient times, yes. Mm. So we have to see these beliefs prior to Islam, mm-hmm. within societies, what they believed in, and what did the religions believe in, and then what did Islam give? And these teachings still stay till today.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
They stay firm till today. Moreover, they used to torture their wives, their mm-hmm. sisters. They would tie them up to chains. They would torture them, keep them there for days, saying that they don't feel pain. They would pour boiling oils on them, saying that, you know, she has no soul. She cannot be inflicted with pain. So this is how women were treated amongst the Greeks and the Romans.
I would say this is kind of generalizing, but this did exist. But like to a certain extent where everyone like believed in that?
Yes, that's how societies were at that time.
Mm-hmm.
It was something normal. Nobody believed that women had value.
Mm-hmm.
They just saw her to be, you know, secondary. Her existence had no purpose.
Was irrelevant?
It was irrelevant.
Mm-hmm.
She's just there to, you know, just like, you know, cattle are existing, you know, they exist, so we eat them, we get milk, food, things like that. Woman is just there to give you children and nothing else. She meant nothing else. She had no value. She didn't deserve any respect. So this is how it was within the Romans and the Greeks. Within the Persian Empire and the Indian territory,
mm-hmm.
the Indians used to believe, the Hindus and the Zardoshians used to believe that a woman only was allowed to live and exist as long as her husband existed. So sometimes, especially at those days where, you know, medicine was not up to date, people would die at an early age. He's 30 years old, all of a sudden he just passes away. 35 years old, he passes away. Those societies believe that she should not be able to exist after the departure of her husband. So in both religions, they used to burn the body of those who passed. They used to place the wives with their dead husbands and burn them together, saying that she can no longer exist or she should not even exist. Her existence is secondary to her husband's existence. She's only existing because of that man. So if that man is gone, then she no longer should be existing. All her rights of survival mm-hmm. and living are stripped away. And if she was to live, then she would live a dishonorable life. She'd have to become, you know, no different than a peasant or stay in her room all her life
mm-hmm.
and not enjoy life for the rest of her life, even if she lived another 40 or 50 years. So these societies all viewed women this way. And they had no value. For instance, in the Chinese cultures, in the ancient Chinese cultures, if a father passed away, then his mother would be given down like an object, inherited to the son. The son could have chose to, have his mother just like his father had, I hope that's clear enough.
Yeah, too.
And he inherited his own mother. His sisters, his they all came as inheritance. And they were just seen like objects, just like he would inherit, you know, the horses, he would inherit the house, he would inherit so on and so forth.
Same with the materialistic stuff.
His mother was not seen anything else than a material. Mm-hmm. She was seen as an object. Mm-hmm. And he would inherit her, mm-hmm. and if he chose to have her like his father did, mm-hmm. he would, or give her away, or just put her in a room. Mm-hmm. And within the Arabic peninsula, before Islam, the Arabian society, it gathered all these brutal and horrific cultures and ways of life into their society. So the Arabs had gathered from the Persians, from the Romans, the Greeks, the Indians, the Chinese. They had brought everything together in demoralizing or dishonoring women, and they would live upon it. For example, they would also inherit their mothers, no different. They would, sell or trade wives and mothers and so on and so forth. It was just, they're having commerce. They're selling a piece of object. You know, I give you that house for this house. I give you this woman from my family for that woman in your family. If someone passes away or someone is killed by one tribe, then this tribe has to give his mother, sister, aunts as, a penalty or a fine. And they would just trade women as they were objects.
Now, this was all pre-Islamic.
This was all pre-Islamic. Within the Arabic peninsula, within Quraysh, within the people who lived in Mecca, mm-hmm. Medina, and within the Arab peninsula, mm-hmm. within, the city of Mecca. This is how the Meccans used to live before Islam came to them. And as we mentioned yesterday, that they had no value for, if they didn't have value for their mothers, then of course they wouldn't have value for their daughters. And we spoke about how mothers would give birth by the grave, and if it was a boy, she would take it, and if it was a girl, she would dump it right away into that grave. And as the Quran mentions the story or this phenomena, بأي ذنب وإذا الموءودة سئلت بأي ذنب قتلت. So also they would say that they don't inherit at all, just like the other cultures and societies. But their interpretation was the only people who inherit are those who carry the sword and protect the egg. So my sons are carrying the sword. They fight. They fight for loot. They fight for survival. They fight for the protection of the egg, the children.
Basically the males.
The males. It was a male dominant society since existence. Since his existence, this is how it's been. And it was at that time when, I had reached the highest of levels of injustice towards women. That's when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the messenger of mercy, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, to this world to bring honor, the true honor that every single woman deserves. Mm-hmm. And to show the world the value that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has truly given a woman and every single female.
Now, did Islam adopt this? Because we do see a lot of people recently following the Muslim religion as Muslims. A lot of misconception has been raised, but based on what Muslims have practiced. And for example, we have people in the East and in the West who treat their women as slaves. They have the idea, they're fond of the idea that women should stay in the kitchen no more, no less. Stay in the kitchen, clean the house, make food, and that's it, raise the children. Whereas in more developed societies, no, even in developed societies, up to today, women have not been given the credit they deserve. But clearing up the misconceptions, did Islam adopt this or did it seek to reform?
No, of course not. But inshallah, we'll get to that in a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Before we get into what Islam brought to societies, I want to clarify before that what the religions before Islam believe.
So for example, or
monotheistic.
Monotheistic, okay.
So Judaism and Christianity. And then we By get into means. Islam, inshallah. So if you look at, you know, just a quick skim through some of their beliefs. For all Jewish males, when they wake up in the morning, they have a morning prayer. Just like when we wake up in the morning, we have Dua al-Sabah by Amir al-Mu'mineen, alayhi afdhal as-salatu was-salam. It's a supplication.
Mm-hmm.
And every Jewish male thanks God. He says, "Blessed are you, Lord, our God, ruler of the universe, who has not created me as a woman." He thanks God that he has not created him as a woman. Meaning that she might be something evil. This is what I kind of understand.
Clearly,
you know?
But is this stated right out of the Old Testament?
It's not throughout the Old Testament, but if you search through their beliefs and ask the rabbis, they'll clarify this and confirm it that we do have this prayer, and you know, it's not something that's ignored or something that is placed in a false position. So they do all believe in this. That it's a blessing that God did not create them as women, because women are definitely lower status than men. And moreover, that because she was an eternal curse, she was cursed eternally by God, because she was the temptress who tempted Adam
to eat from the tree.
So she is the reason behind
the fall of man onto earth.
The fall of man. So her existence till today is the reason behind the fall of man. So whenever you see men failing, it's because of a woman, because they are the temptress.
According Just to like, who? Whose ideology is that?
This is through the Jewish faith.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at, for example, their books, whether it's in the Bible or the Torah, for example, in the Genesis, that she Genesis 3:16, she deserved eternal punishment because she tempted Adam. In Leviticus 12:2-5, he says she was created from his ribs or fell from his side. While we as Muslims, we will explain what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes how Eve was created. So she fell from his side, she fell from his ribs, causing him pain. Mm-hmm. Causing him pain, as some scholars say. Mm-hmm. So her existence will always be of pain, because she caused pain for our father, she tempted our father. And this is merely her reason of existence.
I mean, is that why they say that women have eight or, you know, one rib more than men?
Maybe.
Is that why?
Maybe. Also, within their fiqh or jurisprudence, they believe that a mother who gives birth to a son is only in the state of nifas, as we have, for 7 days. So she's impure for 7 days. But a mother who gives birth to a daughter stays unfilthy for 40 days, because a girl carries more filth and she's a curse. So the mother has to purify herself for 40 days for giving birth to a daughter and a baby girl.
Mm-hmm.
In the book of Exodus, a man can sell his daughter as a slave before she hits puberty. So these are some of the beliefs of prior religions to Islam. And as how many? How
can we go into a break and then continue
the
discussion?
We can go as a break, yes.
So respective viewers, do stay tuned for after the break for we will, inshallah, continue our discussion around how are women viewed pre-Islam and after Islam. That's after the break. So stay tuned.
Assalamu alaikum, liebe Geschwister im Islam. Hier aus Düsseldorf, Deutschland, möchte ich euch zum herzlichen Glückwunsch sagen zum Imam der Zeit, beglückwünschen, Fatima al-Zahra.
Fatima und Amal, ma'naha la tighfal, suratha fir Rahman. شمس وقمر ونجوم وجم البحر موسوم باللولو والمرجان أم الحسن أغلى وطن للعفة والنور
Aus Deutschland, Düsseldorf, beglückwünschen wir صاحب الزمان anlässlich des Geburtstags von Fatima al-Zahra.
برضاها الله ويرضى حبيب الله ويرضى برضاها الله يرضى حبيب الله ومن له ولا يحظى بمنالة ومن له ولا يحظى بمنالة
From Germany, we sent our greetings to Sahib al-Zaman for his grandmother Fatima Zahra alayhi salam and her birthday.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته نهنئ صاحب العصر والزمان العالم الإسلامي من مدينة دوسدورف من ألمانيا بمناسبة مولد فاطمة الزهراء روحي لها الفدا
في آية التطهير تحت الكسى خير النساء رمز هدايا صبح ومساء ما تنسى هذا الرواية نور اصطفاها الله الله عليها الله نور اصطفاها الله الله عليها الله بنيت لالا تهنى بكمالا بنيت لالا تهنى بكمالا
Aus Deutschland, aus Düsseldorf, schicken wir unsere Grüße an unseren Sahib al-Zaman, Haji Batala Farid al-Sharif, unsere Glückwünsche anlässlich des Geburtstags der Prophetentochter Fatima al-Zaman.
تعرفها بالكوثر والشانئ الأبتر بها انطفى وما دام لا سما مبنية ولا أرض مدحية وعزة العلام من تنذكر يضوي الفخر مثل الأهلة
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Hiermit beglückwünschen wir den Imam der Zeit anlässlich des Geburtstags Fatima al-Zahra a.s.
Bismillah, bismillah, tali salam Allah Minha al-asala, wadhar sulala Minha al-asala, wadhar sulala
Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, Once again, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I would like to congratulate you on this very auspicious occasion, which marks the birth anniversary of our pure lady, Lady Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. Before the break, we did touch upon how whether polytheistic religions or modern theistic religions viewed and treated women pre-Islam. This was discussed with my dear guest, Sayed Mudhafar Al-Qazwini. Welcome back, Habib Sayyidina.
Hello,
assalamualaikum. Now, before the break, we did touch upon some regarding how religions pre-Islam viewed and treated women. But how did Islam treat women? Was it, and I do repeat the question, did Islam adopt the same methods or did it seek reform?
Well, first of all, yesterday we mentioned how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi reacted, the master of messengers, mm-hmm. to his newborn mm-hmm. child who was
there's an intention that I want to get to through this question. But yes.
So, starting with the birth of Fatima, mm-hmm. Rasulullah started bringing these new teachings that a girl should not be buried, she has value, she's a blessing, she's this, she's that, and she's the joy of his life, the way he showed her respect, which prior to that, no one used to respect their women or mm-hmm. their daughters. Rasulullah, as I mentioned, used to stand up when she entered the room, he would kiss her forehead, he would kiss her hand, and he would make it public before everyone what she meant to him and how he saw her and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also saw Fatima, peace be upon her. So for your question is, did Islam adopt the lifestyle of societies before Islam? Mm-hmm. Or did it come with a new way of life? Because we see some Muslims today not living any different than the Romans or the Greeks or the Persian, yeah. and so on. So, but you have to understand that there is always cultures, there is always people who do not live based on their religion. And now, for example, do all Muslims pray their five daily prayers?
Let's hope so.
Let's hope so, but yeah. In reality,
yeah,
no, they don't. Do they all fast? No, in reality, we know even in cities like Iraq or Iran or different countries, you know, as we see here, they put a white cloth in the month of Ramadan and there are people breaking their fasts. So you can't generalize that. Why? Because many people don't know what the religion is. What the religion brought. So that's the difference. That this person is living this lifestyle is not because of his religion, it's because he's an arrogant person. He never picked up a book to read what his religion, his Lord, told him to live by. Mm-hmm. So if he was to educate himself and to see how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi treated his wives, treated his daughter, how Islam valued women and gave position for women, then he would understand that he must value his wife and or his daughter and any woman in society. So that's what it comes down to. No, Islam did not adopt any of the cultures or lifestyles of the prior societies or the societies I mentioned or religions. And of course, we as Muslims believe that Allah's commandments never change. So we all, the Bible was changed, so was the Torah. These are not the true teachings of Moses or the true teachings of Jesus, because they would not differ at all from the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. From day one, from the day of creation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave value to every single woman and female. Mm-hmm. But as for misconceptions regarding some verses in the Quran, mm-hmm. that are directed towards us Muslims today, that Look, this is what the Quran says.
Men are superior to, than women.
As the verse says, الرجال قوامون على النساء. So today, we see that in newspapers or, you know, TV shows or people saying that Islam does not give women the same value as men. So what does it mean to be superior or above a woman? What does the Quran try to say? What have exegetes said regarding the illustration of this verse? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is only talking about a nature of a human being. Majority of human beings, you know, 99% of human beings and a makeup of man and woman. Islam is not saying, Allah is not saying that He is superior and she's subordinate or she should be submissive. No, Islam is saying that, or the Quran is saying that, this is a lifestyle. As a child, every single girl wishes to have a man protector, a male protector, whether it's her father, uncle, brother. And things won't change. Even when she wants to get married, she's going to look for a guy who can protect her, mm-hmm. you know, and give her the security she needs. The security not meaning that, you know, he's going to walk as a bodyguard, yeah. but, you know, the security of her knowing that there is a man caring for her and he's present there for her always. That's the nature. That's the nature of females and the nature of man, that he likes to be the protector. And you see that with not just with the human species. You see that with even different species. The male is always the protector, of the herd, the protector of the pack. That's the nature of man. He likes to be, you know, the bread earner. This is why you see a lot of times when a woman earns more than her husband, you'll see him, he's depressed because he cannot do better and earn more bread for the family and provide more for the family than his wife. Because this is a nature of how we were created to want to protect our mothers, daughters, sisters, mothers, wives, every single man, whether even if it's a small child. You see a small 7-year-old boy, you know, maybe he's walking in the street with his mother and someone tries to, you know, harass her. Even that 7-year-old boy will try to protect his mother.
Yeah.
So it does not change. That innate of man and woman is basically what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about.
Mm-hmm. I mean, just how we, you know, interpreted that verse, a lot of people in the West interpret it something differently.
Yes.
What is the correct interpretation? Because the verse basically and straightforward says that men are superior than women.
We do not understand what is the duty of the prophets and messengers. They are there to explain to us what the verses of God are.
Yeah.
What was the duty of Moses, peace be upon him? What was the duty of Jesus, peace be upon him? No, Noah and Jacob and all these messengers and prophets to illustrate to us the words and the teachings of God, because they are the people who truly understand it. So who do you go to? You go to the source, or you go to someone who is trying to make you know, a point that he wants to make. You could abuse the words, anyone's words, the way you like. You know, you could take them out of context. So this is, as Muslims, we should be able to describe what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the Holy Quran. I don't need another person trying to say what my religion is you know, giving to the world. Me as a Muslim, as a, you know, a person who read Muslim books, Muslim heritage, and a follower of Ahl Bayt, I can portray what Ahlul Bayt alayhim afdal as-salatu was-salam said about this verse and this ayah.
Thank you very much for clarifying. Now, one of the main points in speaking of women in general, pre-Islamic and after Islam, specifically in Islam, what were the merits and virtues of Lady Fatima al-Zahra alayhi as-salam, and how is she the role model and symbol for all women despite religions or creeds?
Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Fatima alayha afdal as-salatu was-salam the position of being Sayyidat Nisa al-Alameen, meaning being the mistress of all women in both worlds, this life and in the afterlife. And we see the positions of prophets and imams in our belief to be the highest of creations, correct? And amongst them, amongst those men, was a woman. Mm-hmm. And that woman was Fatima alayha afdal as-salatu was-salam. And it wasn't just adjacent to them, but it was just as significant as we read in the hadith al-Qudsi, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he addresses Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi and says, Ya Ahmed, lawlak lama khalaqtu al-aflak, walawla Ali lama khalaqtuk, walawla Fatima lama khalaqtukuma. O Ahmed, if it was not for you, I would have not created the universe, this whole entire world. And if it was not for your cousin Ali ibn Abi Talib, I would have not created you. And if it was not for Fatima, alayha afdal as-salatu was-salam, peace be upon her, I would have not created you or Ali ibn Abi Talib. Some see her to even be more significant. Her existence,
does
the existence
show?
Of a woman is probably even more significant, because through her came the imams, through her came guidance. As Jibra'il alayhi afdal as-salatu was-salam in Hadith al-Kisa says, Allahumma salli ala Fatimata wa abiha wa ba'liha wa baniha. She is the center point of guidance. O Allah, send your blessings and salam and peace upon Fatima and her father, and her Fatima and her husband, and Fatima and her children. Showing how important she is. And as Imam al-Sadiq alayhi afdal as-salatu was-salam says, we are the proof of Allah upon people, and our mother Fatima is the proof upon us. Giving her the highest of statuses that no other creation has had. نَحْنُ حُجَّةُ اللَّهِ عَلَىٰ خَلْقِهِ وَأُمُّنَا فَاطِمَةُ حُجَّةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْنَا حُجَّةِ اللَّهِ عَلَيْنَا.
Yeah.
She is proof upon us. She is our guider. So, giving the significance to a woman and a female that has not existed in any religion or any society. And she was there from the first moment of creation. And through the books of both schools of thought, when Adam made that mistake, and the majority of hadiths within the Sunni's books, that when Adam mentioned the names and asking Allah for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant him for forgiveness, he asked, O Allah, I ask you by the sake of Muhammad, Ali, Fatima, and Hassan, and Hussein, those lights around your throne to repent upon me. So she's just as significant, and her light and her existence was there with the existence of the, at the time of the nur of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alih. And it was her existence that brought light. The hadith says that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the universe, it was through the light of Fatima alayha afdal as-salatu was-salam that light came back to the darkness. Mm-hmm. And the angels asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Oh Allah, what is this light?" The response was that this is the light of Fatima alayha, ana fatiru as-samawati wal-ard. وَهَذَا نُورُ فَاطِمَ بِنْتِ مُحَمَّدٍ اللَّهُمَّ صَلَّ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ وَآلِ مُحَمَّدٍ. And it was through her light that the world became illuminated once again. And this was before existence. And on the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her the position to be the first person to give shafa'a and intercession. She will be the first person. A woman stands before all the creations, before the creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and she is the first person to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to pardon this person and that person. For her sake, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept. And the first person who enters paradise in the hadith, it's not a man, it's Fatima alayha afdal as-salati was-salam.
Now, one of her titles and merits is the Lady of Light. Now, why was she named this?
She was named exactly for the hadith that I mentioned, mm-hmm. because her light brought illuminated the whole universe. Mm-hmm. She is the essence of light. That's why she's called as Zahra alayha afdal as-salati was-salam through the hadiths of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
There's another narration which, why, you know, for every imam, for every prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the name to that individual. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Prophet Muhammad to name his child Fatima. What is Fatima? What's the significance of Fatima?
Fatima comes from Fatima. Fatima is stripping away. So, for example, if you want to stop breastfeeding a child, they say his mother made this act, Fatima. Fatamat ibnaha min al-rada'a. So she took breastfeeding away from him. So detached. Mm-hmm. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi says she will detach her followers and lovers from Nara Jahannam. And فُطِمَ النَّاسِ مِن مَعْرِفَتِهَا. People will never understand the position of this woman, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave this female and what honor He gave her. فُطِمَ النَّاسِ مِن مَعْرِفَتِهَا. And this is why the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi was called Fatima. Mm-hmm. Peace be upon her.
Peace be upon her. And I would like to thank you very much for joining us tonight.
May Allah bless you, brother.
May Allah bless you as well. And keep us on the path of Ahlul Bayt alayhi
salam.
Ameen. Thank you once again. Respected viewers, thank you very much for tuning in tonight. Hopefully, inshallah, we can get to understand the difference between what Islam has brought to teach and what people want to make themselves understand about Islam. Once again, thank you very much. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum.